Hello everyone and welcome back to another video on DBT. In the last video we went through installing and setting up your first project, and now in this video we will focus on sources and adding sources to your project and trying to understand why you would need that and how it's used. So sources are ultimately they're a YAML file in the terms of DBT. And the way I like to think about this is sources are the raw data tables that everything else gets built on top of. The default location for sources is set to the models directory. And you can see that if we hop back in here in our DBT project, it's set here. You can change that. For the sake of this, we won't, but just understand that that is an option. And you can learn a lot more about the different configurations and properties that you can set by going to these links here. And I'll make sure to attach this. So what I will be doing here in as an example in our Snowflake environment is looking at this Snowflake sample data database. And this is provided when you sign up for an account. And it reminds me a lot of AdventureWorks with some of the Microsoft stack, if you're familiar with that. And the schema we will look at is this one right here. Just has a couple built-in tables within it. So what we want to do is set something like, let's say, store sales, we want to be able to refer to this as a source. So how would we add this as a source? And that's what we'll do here. So let's hop back in here. If we go into models, remember we have this example folder, but let's make a new one. And I'll call this Snowflake sample data. How you name this is completely up to you. At the end of the day, everything in DBT is just a bunch of files and folders, so you can add as many folders and files as you want, break it down how you want, it's really up to you. So we'll create a new folder here, and within this, we'll just create a schema.yaml file. Understanding how YAML files work is outside the scope of this video, and the way I like to think about YAML is it's very similar to JSON in the way it's nesting objects together. Now, YAML files can be used to describe models themselves. You can add descriptions and tests to models, as well as sources. So you'll see both of those often intermingling within DBT. In this case, as we said, we're focused on sources. So how would we create a source YAML file? So let's hop back to the documentation. We're at sources. And here is an example, like they show, models, filename.yaml. It really doesn't matter what you call it. Let's copy this just as a starting point. Now the way this is broken down is up top you have version 2. That just needs to be there by default. I don't know exactly why that's needed, but just understand that you have to put it there. Sources here lets the engine recognize that this is for sources, it's not for models. You give a name to the source, and then you can identify the different tables involved. In this case, there's two different sources with different tables. For our sake here, let's just focus on one. And we will say name. I'm going to match it with the name of the database. So I will call this Snowflake Sample Data. And the table we will be concerned with right now is just store sales. Some other information I like to add to this is the specific database and schema. And if we go to the source properties, I believe it should break it down. Yeah, so there's a lot of information you can add here. In our case, I like to add these three. Actually, description, database, and schema, I think are good ones to start with. So we'll add this here. Give a description to the source. It doesn't really matter. We'll just say a sample database provided by Snowflake. Database is the name, and the schema is this guy right here, which is this. And the table name. So you can see here, we're just giving the description of these different attributes. And just so we don't confuse this here, this is the name of the source. This is how we will refer to it. And this is the name of the database in Snowflake itself. So anywhere we use that source function, we need to refer to it from this name here, not here. Just because they're the same here, it doesn't matter. This is how it will be referred to throughout DBT. So then we have, again, the schema and the table. We could add a description to this as well and say, details about the sales in the store. Not very useful, but you get the idea. And now if you really wanted, you could even get as specific as the columns. You could say, you could add columns. I think it's like this actually. Columns, and go line by line through each column and add tests and add descriptions and get really, really specific. But for the sake of this, let's just keep it here. So now we have a source. We've created our source. We've given it a name, a description, pointed it to a database, schema, etc. Now, how can we use this? Let's create a model that just selects from this sample data. We'll create a model for the store sales. We'll name this snowflake sample data 2_store sales.sql. Now the naming of this, there's a whole bunch of opinions on how you would name it, but what is most important is that each model needs to have a unique name. You cannot have two models with the same name, and the files need to be unique. A common strategy is prefix it with the name of the folder. That way you can be sure that the file names are unique, and then ultimately how you name the models are unique, and you can kind of save yourself there. As we saw in the first video, the models are just SQL scripts with some Jijna in it that ultimately create the data model in our data warehouse. There's also a ton of documentation and discussion on the best ways to write your model scripts and to format your syntax here. Again, I'm not going to get too far into that. There's a ton of information that you can find on it. But one of the most common ways to do this is to use CTEs, or common table expressions, to group up your information and then have a final select. So for example here, with and then the name of what you want to call this. So we'll call this source store sales as, and then within these brackets is where you can do your select statement. And what we will do here is just select all from, and in this case, instead of putting the actual full name of the table, we can use the source shortcut. So let's go back using sources. We can use this source Jijna function just like they have it here. So let's do that. Select all from the source, source name, table. I'm going to split this up here side by side. Now, the source name, again, that is the name here. So let's put this in here in quotations. And then the table name will be, in this case, store sales. So what this is saying is it's going to look for any source file that has this name and the table with this name. Got it? So now we will select all from that CTE. A way you'll actually see this is it actually puts everything into a final table. So even though we only have one CTE, it seems a little redundant, but again, feel free to check out the documentation on why this is used. Obviously this would be a lot more interesting if there was more logic, but the idea is to finish with a select from final in everything that you do. Start with your source, you put everything in CTEs, and then you select from a final CTE. So now let's try to run this. If we open up a terminal, and let's do a DBT run. And what this should do is actually look for all of the models in our project, so it will also find these, as well as this new one. So it's running three models. and they were all successful. That's great, which means that this successfully used this source to copy this information, and in our case, move it from this source to our other database where we're pointing this DBT project. And if you remember from the last video, we pointed that to the demo DB. So everything should land in this demo DB, and we have pointed it to public. And if we look in here, we have the first ones as well as our new one. So here it is. On the next video, I'll show you a little bit more about how this data is actually compiled under the hood and what it looks like in case you ever want to debug and understand the actual logic going on behind it. So thank you for watching. If you have any questions, please leave a comment, and we'll see you at the next video.